Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. I've been given this opportunity to talk with you about how the Lord has opened the hearts and minds of many men and women, not only for a deeper relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ, but with His church. Many of them, that was not where they anticipated to end up as they sought to follow our Lord. But yet, by the mercy of God, hearts and minds are open to see the beauty of the fullness of the faith. Such is true of our guest tonight, Father Jurgan Liias, former Anglican priest. And Father Jurgan, welcome.
Well, it's a privilege and an honor to having watched this show for many years. To wind up being a guest here is a great honor.
And as you know, as we've talked, although I have heard your story, though I've need to be reminded, but it was in the Coming Home Network newsletter recently. But you have many connections with folk that our audience may know, especially Tom Howard.
That's right. That's right. With my last Anglican cure was in the North Shore, there where you went to seminary many, many years ago,
right.
At Gordon Conwell Seminary, and so that know a lot of the folk in that area and that.
And I'm always looking for an opportunity to remind our audience of Tom Howard and his wonderful writings, like on Being Catholic.
That's right. And he's your number one guest, right?
That's right. So first Journey Home
700-something shows ago, he was number one. Matter of fact, I was just with him last week. I was bringing a young college student from Gordon College, which is in our neighborhood, who had he and I had both been catechizing and brought him into the church. And in the Ordin area, which I'm part of, I have faculties to confirm. So I confirmed that Tom was a sponsor, and we had a wonderful liturgy there with a whole bunch of students there. So we're hoping to work on those nice young innocent evangelical kids. I think they're a mission field for Catholics.
That's right. Well, to help them, it's kind of like Catholics. We sometimes have to be awakened to the beauty we have that we take for granted. Well, same thing with our evangelical brothers and sisters who, by God's grace, love our Lord Jesus, love Scripture,
right.
But they need to be awakened to where that Scripture came from.
That's right.
And even their faith in Christ and the creeds, where all that came from. So, I mean, that's really what our work is.
Yeah, that's I know Monsignor Steenson, who I know you've interviewed, who is my ordinary and sort of my bishop, you might say, has said, tell all those evangelicals, because like me, because he's a strong evangelical background, said, tell all those evangelicals, they need to leave nothing behind. They just get more of everything.
Right.
More Bible, more riches of the faith. And I think that's really true. It's not abandoning something. It's just coming into, as we often say, the fullness of faith.
Well, yeah. I mean, for example, you take the Trinity and the divinity of Christ. Well, an evangelical, and I struggled with this at Gordon Conwell. Mm. I believed in the Trinity. I believed in the divinity of Christ. But with the Bible alone, you can feel very nervous about which scriptures do I put together to come up with the Trinity or the divinity of Christ. But then when they discover the fullness of the sacred tradition, which scripture is a part of,
yeah.
Now we see the Holy Spirit guiding the early church to understand the Trinity and divinity of Christ and the Eucharist and all of that. But we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Yeah, we're all to today, but where do you want me to begin?
I want you to go way back, long before you even thought about getting any collar around your neck.
Well, I do believe in prevenient grace, and certainly a lot of my journey, I mean, I have a strange name, Jurgan Liias. I was born in Germany, but my father was a refugee from Estonia at the end of World War II. He actually was shot and wounded and had to have his leg amputated, and he was put on a German hospital train who had been occupying Estonia. But as the Russians came in, he was moved out, never to go home again. He lost everything, his country. He was actually married before, his wife, his children. He had two little boys. He lost his leg. He lost his home, everything. It was just incomprehensible, the kind of loss. Meanwhile, my mother grew up in what became East Germany. And she had somewhat a similar. One day the sirens went off, said all women and children get on the next train. The Russians are coming. And she wound up getting on a train. She was 19 years old, never saw her family again. By the time both of the trains, I always have this image of these two trains going upon the destruction of post-World War II Eastern Europe and Germany, and wind up in a little town in the Black Forest called Schwenningen am Neckar, on the Neckar River. And that's where they met and rebuilt a new life. And I was born in 1948, was baptized in the Lutheran church. I've actually been to that little church in one of my travels to Germany.
Now, was that Lutheran church, because during the war, you had the state church, and you had the, what was the other church?
The Confessing Church.
The Confessing Church.
Like Bonhoeffer and people like that. I have no idea what I don't know. Never. That's a good question. Next time I go back, I do a little history on it. Probably it was part of the, you know, official, like everyone, most churches tragically just towed the line.
But even in 48, when you were born and during that time, that was a rough time for the churches right after the war.
Exactly,
right?
Exactly. Yeah. But because I was baptized, but my parents applied for emigration. And eventually, we wound up coming to the United States as DPs, they were called in those days, displaced persons. We actually spent a good part of my childhood in displaced person camps, first in Germany, then in the United States. People don't know we actually had refugee camps on this side of the Atlantic.
Where were they at? I mean, and, in Massachusetts? Or?
Yeah, actually, the one we wound up coming into New York, and I don't know all the details of my, because I was only 4 years old at the time, but we eventually settled in a for about 6 months in a refugee camp in Western Massachusetts. And then my father came to Boston to look for a place, a job, and a place for us to live. And this is part of the prevenient grace. We wound up settling, being taken in by a celibate Episcopal priest into his rectory. He was very active in resettling refugees. We weren't the only ones actually living in this rectory. It was a big, enormous brownstone. And we wound up living in the rectory. And this is a part that's interesting in terms of my Catholicism. It was Charlestown was a section of Boston, which was a rough, blue-collar Irish Catholic neighborhood. And literally, I mean this, I used to get beaten up, and even my parents would get rocks thrown at them for being Protestants and Nazis. It was not, I've forgiven them all, but that was my first encounter with Catholicism, was being beaten up for being a Protestant, and because I only spoke German when I got here, or being a Nazi. And the church.
What a time that would have been if you're German in the late 40s, early 50s.
50s. Yeah. Wow. So the war was still going on, the bitterness around that war. Interesting enough, that little Episcopal church became our home and our extended family, a place that was safe. And from the time as a little boy, as far back as I can remember, I wanted to be a priest. So my vocation was something that came early. My mother says I used to, when playing with my siblings, I was the oldest of four. One other was born in Germany, two in this country. I used to, for when we played together, I would give out communion. And my father was the sexton at the church. He has a little side job, which just involved going down on Saturdays and cleaning the church for Sunday. And he often would send me down to do the job for him. And I used to practice preaching from the pulpit there to these empty pews after sweeping and vacuuming the church. So that never changed. I wanted to be a priest.
Both Pope Benedict and Pope Francis have strongly emphasized to Catholics that they need to have a intimate personal relationship with our Lord, not merely an external. There you were already drawn to being a priest, doing the things of a priest. Was it inside you at that age?
Well, yes and no. I mean, I certainly had a relationship to God, but I would not call myself, as we would say in evangelical circles, a born-again Christian. Yeah. And in fact, the formation I had already in Sunday school certainly went on through high school, particularly in college, and then most of all in seminary, where I went to a Episcopal seminary, was liberal Protestant. And the prevailing kind of theological system, as you well know, is sort of, you know, demythologizing Christianity, desupernaturalizing it. And I pretty much bought that line. I mean, I wanted to be a contemporary. I mean, I believed in Christianity in a certain extent, although only later did I realize that I was not really a Christian in any, I think, really important way. But I wanted to be a contemporary man. I was a bright student. I got a full scholarship to, originally I was going to go to Harvard, but my mother said I'd have to live at home. So I wound up going to Amherst College, which is one of the sort of elite schools in New England. But it was an off to seminary where that kind of deconstruction of Christianity continued.
Which Sam, can I ask?
Episcopal Theological School, which was in Cambridge. It's now the Episcopal Divinity School.
But I was going to get it. It was a part of that consortium.
Yeah, part of the consortium you were part of. Gordon Conwell was part of.
But most of the consortium had pretty much bought into that line of critical thinking.
Absolutely, absolutely. And of course, in those days, this was post-Vatican II, even the Catholic Church was, for the first generation after Vatican II, started buying into a lot of liberal Protestantism. Thank God, I think that's... I remember hearing Cardinal Schönborn, who, as you know, was one of the architects of the Catechism, speak at a conference I was at, an Alpha conference, interesting enough, in London. And he said those years when we followed Bultmann, we lost a lot of ground those years, I hope we have restored. But it was interesting enough, after I was ordained a priest, I was joking, you say I was ordained first and converted later, I was working, actually it started my last year of seminary before I was ordained, I was working in a parish where the priest believed in spiritual healing. And there was a little group of crazy ladies who got together after our weekday service and would study the Bible and pray together as if they believed that their prayer actually could make a difference. And I had just been taught that Jesus never healed anyone, according to Bultmann, that this was all legendary creations. And suddenly I said, well, if Jesus didn't do this, what do these people think they're doing? And it really became the beginning of a paradigm shift. And then after I was ordained, the charismatic movement was breaking out within the Episcopal Church. Mm-hmm. Interesting enough, again, in terms of my Catholicism, first place I encountered the charismatic movement was in a Catholic church. There was a Catholic church up the street from the Episcopal Church I was a curate at, and they had a weekly, the church was packed, quite enthusiastic, charismatic mass and prayer meeting following. And that was my first exposure to the charismatic renewal. Originally, I must say, I thought it was a little crazy, but it was something that drew me in. And it was through the charismatic renewal that I had a profound conversion to Christ.
Our guest tonight is Father Jurgan Liias, former Anglican. Before we move completely, now you've in your journey, you've awakened to the authentic faith through the preaching and also the charismatic renewal. I just want to step back a little bit with that influence of Bultmann and others. At that time period in the history of the Anglican Church that you were a part of after the war and all that, and we see where it's gone today. Would you say that because of what was happening in that time period in those seminaries and that teaching, there really was the foundation to end up where it's gone? Because if you start cutting away at, well, Jesus didn't say that, and that wasn't true, and the resurrection was really a symbolic thing, I mean, it really undercuts any reason to hold on to traditional morality, traditional understanding of marriage, traditional family, because everything
absolutely.
Is...
Absolutely. It just eviscerates the faith. I mean, of course, again, I didn't know that at the time. To give credit to liberalism, what they're trying to do is make the faith palatable and acceptable. But unfortunately, in that effort, I think it was even Tillich who said before he died, he noticed his theology had become already obsolete. I mean, I think he began to see that his experiment in making Christianity relevant was already irrelevant. and it was, I think that's true. I think it was a eviscerating of Christianity, a deconstructing of it to the point where there's really nothing. I always like to say, I mean, a lot of it is what I call spiritually sterile. It actually is not able to regenerate souls.
Yeah.
It's sterile.
Yeah. Father Packwell calls them spiritual geldings.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's his idea. In the name of being authentic.
Yeah, yeah.
In the name of being
credit,
authentic.
They were trying to save Christ from modernity, and unfortunately they lost Christ to modernity, I would say.
Which would have been Father Newhouse's statement. You know, that was his, it was a Catholic moment he saw, that we have, the Catholic Church had the chance to reach through this stuff, and whether we've captured that or not.
Yeah.
So there you are, a curate finding Jesus.
That's right. And my pastor at the time, who was a wonderful mentor to me about the craft of being a parish priest, was not excited about the direction I was going. In fact, I remember it was a tearful conversation one time I had with him, and he said, "Jurgan, you could have been a bishop someday, and you've thrown it all away." But what began to happen, this again, a journey towards Catholicism, it's interesting, when I had that kind of profound conversion to Christ, and it was a conversion actually to the atonement, to the blood of Christ. I actually had a vision of the blood of Christ, which again, when you think about how important that is to Catholicism, and the Eucharistic mystery, But the basic doctrines of the faith, the resurrection, and all that I had deconstructed, the atonement, the incarnation, all of that I began to believe in and began to proclaim. I was pastor of a little dying Episcopal church. We had a wonderful renewal and grew. But it's interesting, from the early on in after my experience, I had another kind of vision God gave me about the nature of the church. And it was a church, it was three streams, you might have heard this vision, flowing together into one river. And each stream represented, you might say, the life of God in the church. One was what we call, I would call the Catholic stream, the sacramental, liturgical, historical stream. Another was the evangelical, with the emphasis upon the scripture and the word of God and personal conversion to Jesus. And the third was the charismatic or Pentecostal, which was the experience of the mystical, the supernatural, the Pentecostal gifts and all of that. And I saw all these streams coming together into one river. And that kind of was my vision of as an Anglican Episcopal priest for the next, 30 years after my conversion, of creating a church that was fully Catholic, fully evangelical, and fully charismatic. So wherever I went,
it sounds like fully Trinitarian.
Well,
Father,
anyway,
Son, Holy Spirit.
Exactly. There are a lot of components to that, being one dimension of that. And in some sense, I tried to create that kind of church. So we had a strong, high theology of which, of course, is part of Anglicanism, or parts of Anglicanism. Proclaimed the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, really talked about the seven sacraments, not just the two. Our liturgy was incense and bells and kind of high church liturgy. But we preached, 30-minute sermon and a good evangelical preaching. And we also believed in the gifts of the Holy Spirit and healing and manifestations of that. And wherever I went over the next 30 years or at different parishes I was affiliated with, I really tried to, in a sense, live out that kind of vision.
Were you finding camaraderie, or were you a gadfly?
Oh, both. I mean, the vision was not something just given to me, and I know a lot of Anglican priests also had a similar vision, and it's something that was driving particularly the more conservative wing Episcopal and Anglicanism.
But you might have had more support amongst your evangelical, non-Anglican brothers and
sisters. Well, what was interesting is I got, for example, when I was at Christ Church Hamilton, even before that, when I was in an urban area near Boston, then I was in downtown Boston, had a lot of Gordon Conwell seminarians show up. And they were excited by that vision. Of course, most of them had not had exposure to the liturgical sacramental, what I call Catholic with a small c, and were drawn to the Eucharist, drawn to the sacrament. So I probably brought 30, 40, 50 Gordon Conwell students into the priesthood of the Anglican Church. And it was that vision that kind of captured them.
And it sounds like that direction, that emphasis that you're saying, which is the liturgy, a new birth in Christ, as well as the charismatic fulfillment of all that. Right. I mean, that was a bit parallel even to Tom Howard's book, Evangelical Is Not Enough.
Right. That's right.
I mean, it sounds like he was saying the same thing, that this rebirth of Christ in the hearts of Anglicans.
I think, of course, the Holy Spirit is moving, and I think there often is this synchronicity and this similar kinds of way God is moving. I think even within the Catholic Church, rediscovery of the charismatic element. Even the fact that we're talking about the new evangelization is a rediscovery of the evangelical component. And for me, actually, I never abandoned that vision. I just, however, came to the conclusion remember I said I want to be fully Catholic, fully evangelical, fully charismatic. I finally came to the conclusion I could not be fully Catholic without the magisterium. That it wasn't just the sacramental life. It wasn't just a high theology.
What was happening to you then as a priest, the Anglican priest that was making you?
Well, of course, I and a lot of my
first, by this time you're married and have a family.
Yeah, I forgot them. Very important part of my life. I did meet my wife in college, and we've been married 43 years.
Praise God.
And have two children, grown children, and now three grandchildren. So that's an important. My wife, interestingly, was a mathematician. And spent 30 years working at MIT. So she was the brains in the family. Also created an interesting, you know, religion science dialectic in our household, which still goes on. I'm still praying she would become a Catholic. She's not become a Catholic. She's a very devout Anglican and very faithful in that realm, but hasn't come across the Tiber yet. But back to...
At what point, so you said you had some things early on, maybe a little Catholic Church, but was there ever a point when even the idea of considering the Catholic Church, when did that?
Well, actually, that's a good point, because it was something that began to be present in my heart and mind a long time ago. The first place I began to really think it was I began to be a voice on pro-life issues in the Episcopal Church,
and particularly the Massachusetts. A lone voice sometimes.
Very lone, particularly in Massachusetts, which is not only politically the most liberal state, but the Episcopal Church in Massachusetts that I was a member of was always considered itself on the cutting edge of the future. And so it was the first place that had a woman bishop. It was the first place that was embracing homosexual unions. And the liberal theology was very dominant. And of course, I was sort of, after my conversion, this sort of almost counter-cultural movement within the Episcopal Church. On not only theologically but also morally, and I started a chapter of what used to be called the NOEL, National Organizations of Episcopalians in Life, but we really were a voice crying in the wilderness, and it was both. And interesting enough, I never experienced so much hostility. I mean, the charismatic stuff was a little eccentric, so I didn't get overt hostility to that, but the pro-life stuff. I mean, there was pretty adamant, extreme feminism that it was a dominant voice in our church, and so I was really considered a real, misogynist because I did not support, abortion rights and all that, and so we were a lonely voice. Although it was an interesting thing too. Every once in a while, some woman priest would call me up and come visit me and talk to me. Say, I really. Actually agree with you deep down inside. So, there is what the Catholic would say, deep down inside, the truth is in there,
The seed.
Of conscience in the Holy Spirit.
But with
that's why I said, maybe I'm in the wrong church. And of course, most of my colleagues in the political square, public square, were Catholics. And so I found myself very lonely, but also finding... and then I had a very interesting actual spiritual experience. I was one night reading a book called The New Catholics. And Tom Howard's in that book. I know he's mentioning him.
Right.
And I don't know if I was reading his... But it was a series of conversion stories, not unlike your book, Journey Home.
That was an earlier
version. Yeah, an early version.
That was an early
version. I remember it was the eve of the Epiphany, because I was on sabbatical leave. I have a little cabin in New Hampshire where I go off my day off. I'm sitting there reading this book, and I swear to God, one of those times in my life, I heard God say to me, Jurgan, you will be a Catholic before you die. That's what I heard. Mm-hmm. That was something like 25 years ago when that happened. Now, I must confess, I was sipping a little brandy at the time, so I'm not completely sure which spirit. But it was so real that I actually began the process of the pastoral provision, which was available back then.
Right.
This was like around 1988 when this experience happened, so literally a little over 25 years ago. But it's interesting, as I started the process, I even went and met with a bishop in the Archdiocese of Boston and spoke about, I was doing spiritual direction with a Franciscan priest and helping me discern the voice of God around of becoming a Catholic. And yet, without going into full details, something, the Holy Spirit, you know how it says in Acts 16, the Holy Spirit prevented us from going there? I felt the Holy Spirit say, not yet. And it was there, the yearning was there, but I really did feel the Holy Spirit said, not yet. And then I, interesting enough, right after that, I was called to be a associate priest at a place, an Episcopal church called Church of the Advent, which is in downtown Boston. It is the mother church of Anglo-Catholicism. It was actually founded in 1844 to promulgate the principles of the Oxford Movement. For those who maybe in the audience don't know what the Oxford Movement, this was the movement started by John Henry Newman, now blessed John Henry Newman. And it was a movement to restore Catholicism to the Anglican Church and to restore Anglicanism to full communion with Rome. That was the original vision of the Oxford Fathers, and Newman, of course, being the most famous of that group.
Of course, the group that became Catholic, not all like Pius.
But the original fathers saw this. This was their kind of vision, and Newman finally came to the conclusion that he had to make that journey alone rather than with in communion. And of course, I do see what the ordinariate is as almost 150 years later. Being, in a sense, the fruit of that vision in a very organic way. But we're getting ahead of ourselves again. So I worked at this parish, and it was a deeper immersion into the Catholic faith. I mean, it was, for example, most people are surprised, particularly Roman Catholics are surprised, that in Anglo-Catholic churches you will have devotion to the Virgin Mary, groups that get together to say the rosary, requiem masses for the dead on Saturday mornings. I mean, things that would, which probably technically are forbidden in the Anglican Church, according to the 39 articles and things like that. But nonetheless, we're going on. And so that actually, in a way, even though the Lord said not yet, it's almost like he immersed me into Catholicism as it was actually going on, a certain in the Anglican Church.
Sometimes I wonder if the reason that the Lord opens a heart to the church but then says not yet is because there's still baggage we've got to deal with in the process.
That's true.
You know, how much are you going to bring with you? How much are you going to leave behind? What is it that you're actually going to? And then we've got some maturing to do. I don't know if that was true for you.
No, I think that's true. And although, you know, it's the mystery of God's timing is always a great part of the mystery. And so I was there for a while. And then I went to your neighborhood where you went to seminary. I became rector of Christ Church of Hamilton Wenham, which was a strong evangelical Anglican church, Episcopal church. And I, in a way, it was interesting because I brought all these things I'd brought from the Advent to Christ Church, which hadn't been there before. And really, I like to say, introduce. In fact, I remember I got the local Catholic priest, Father Bourgeois, a wonderful guy. I went to him one day. I said, Father Bourgeois, I'm introducing Catholicism to Christ Church, Hamilton. Would you help me out? I need vestments. He went up to the attic of St. Paul's Rectory to church there in Hamilton, came down with an armful of chasubles, because they didn't wear chasubles or anything like that at Christ Church, and gave them to me. And then there was a little retreat house down of Salesian brothers down the street. I used to go private retreats there, and they were closing up. And literally, it was like a booty. I brought tabernacles, vestments, Stations of the Cross, all these things.
Well, and you could have got a lot of that stuff from Gordon Conwell, because that used to be a minor seminary before. Let's pause there, because we need to take a break.
All right.
Father Jurgan Liias is our guest. We'll come back in a moment. Just as he takes over a more evangelical Anglican church, and we'll see how that continued the journey. So we'll be back just a second. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm your host, Marcus Grodi. Our guest is Father Jurgan Liias, a former Anglican. We've paused in the middle of your journey where you've gone up to my old stomping ground near Gordon-Conwell.
Well, in time, it's 1997 now.
Okay.
I just began as pastor of Christ Church Hamilton, which again was in the neighborhood of Gordon-Conwell Seminary, where you went to seminary many years ago. And I said I want to introduce Catholicism to that parish. I just told the story of getting vestments and Stations of the Cross and tabernacles. All these things were new to that parish. But I did introduce everything. I mean, I've always felt the important is the education around liturgy and everything. So I didn't just impose all these things, but I really taught, wrote, and every Sunday there'd be inserts into the program about some aspect of liturgy, why we do this, what it means, and all that. And also, what's interesting was, there were some people upset. I mean, I know a family I remember visiting. They said, "We can't. This church is becoming too Catholic. We're leaving." Yeah. On the other hand, again, you'd be sympathetic to this, knowing that world. I suddenly had all these Gordon-Conwell seminarians and tons of Gordon College kids showing up, and actually, this was all new to them. But because I was showing how this is all in the Bible and everything, it intrigued them. So, in fact, the church, I did lose some people, but on the other hand, the church like doubled in size within like a year or two, and so it was an exciting time. The first time we ever did the triduum in that church, you know, with the full triduum, with all the all the riches of the liturgies of Holy Week. It was a wonderfully successful, the church thrived. It was really in many ways the most satisfying and fulfilling an enjoyable part of my life as an Anglican priest. But the problem was the storms outside my parish. I mean, we were pretty Orthodox-minded, biblically faithful, thriving congregation. But around us was the continuing deconstruction of the faith in so many levels. And of course, the homosexual issue in particular became an enormous challenge, and we were, my parish and myself were very involved in the, I've always felt called that part of my vocum FX in my ordination vows as an Anglican to participate in the councils of the church. So I was, you know, on one hand trying to run this thriving parish, on the other hand trying to engage in the councils of the church as a voice opposing the direction that the church was going. So it was, so that part, when I was back at the church, things were great, but being in the public square, but I felt that there had to be a voice, as there was in the, on the pro-life thing.
And it would be such a hard voice to try and do within your Anglican community there, because just as we were talking about earlier, when you have a tradition that the foundation for what it believes is the Bible, yet guided by the councils, there you have it. Well, when you look at scripture, a faith that's based on that, there really is no opening door to accept the homosexual agenda.
That's right.
Unless you have that background of undercutting the Bible's authority all along.
Yeah.
Then there you go.
And the thing that most troubled me was, because my bishop, who was a personal friend, and we had a respectful relationship, even though I was sort of loyal opposition, I was still loyal, and we had a relationship of mutual affection. But it always troubled me that I would say one thing from the pulpit, and my bishop would say the other. And it wasn't so much even the opposition between us. It was the fact, like, I didn't want this to be a thing where you of opinions, you know, accept my opinion, or maybe I could be more eloquent and more reasonable than the bishop. You might accept my opinion, but of course he's the bishop. So it just said, I'm not interested in promoting the religion of Jurgan Liias. And it began even more this yearning, which I think most folk who become from a Protestant background become Catholic, for some clarity of authority of where is the truth, and where, how do we know the truth, how do we find the truth. Secondly, in those years, because of what was going on, there began to emerge a strong new movement within the Episcopal Church of called realignment, and there was some effort. Interesting, that's where I first met Monsignor Steenson. He was at the time the bishop of the Rio Grande, which was down the southwestern part of the country.
And
he was an Anglican bishop, right. And we would have these big national meetings of strategy. Well, what do we do in the face of what we would say the apostasy, prevailing apostasy, the Episcopal Church? And there began to be, you know, the desire to actually create a separate Anglican entity breaking away from the Episcopal Church. And I remember in particular a very significant conversation I had with Monsignor, who then was the Bishop of Steenson, an Episcopal bishop, going for a long walk at one of these conferences, one of these sort of big political convocations we had, trying to figure out how to respond to the apostasy in the Episcopal Church. And both of us saying, that was the first time we mutually confessed our attraction to Rome. Again, to make a long story short, even though I did join this realignment and actually started a new Anglican church, my heart, something in it said, this is Protestantism. This is every time you want to, you know, deal with the apostasy and heresy that's prevalent in a church, you start a new denomination. And then you just wait 50 or 100 years, and then you've got the project all over again, because that, you know, Methodism broke away from Anglicanism for the sake of Jesus Christ. Now Methodism is, you know, in turmoil. It just, and of course, Anglicanism says it broke away for theology. And I finally said, this is not the way to do church. This is not the way to renew the church, and then when the ordinariate was formed, of course, Pope Benedict established that in an apostolic constitution in 2009, Anglicanorum Caelibus. There was something about that profoundly caught my imagination. Because suddenly it was not, I've always yearned for the unity of the church, and given the divisions with Anglicanism, even more for the unity of the church. And my heart was always kind of a Catholic ecclesiology, and Protestantism, although there are wonderful things, you know, I've learned from Pentecostals and evangelicals, it was just something of the divisions and the all that just was always profoundly troublesome. And when he established a provision for Anglicans to come into the Catholic Church, into full communion with the see, be submitted to the magisterium, and yet retain their patrimony, was the word he used, there was something that said this is a profound prophetic action for the first time 500 years, an actual organic vehicle for reunion for a Protestant church that had broken away.
Would have been, you know, behind us on the wall here, we've got the Pope of the bust of St. John the 23rd.
Yeah.
And so what we see in this ordinariate 30, 40 years later, from the beginning of why was St. John calling this council, that we see it fleshed out in the ordinariate.
That's right. I mean, you read the Vatican II aspects of the ecumenical components of those documents. There's already a profound vision of separated brethren rather than, you know, I grew up in Charlestown. Literally, the kids I grew up with said, oh, Jurgan, they were my friends. They were not saying this, and these were not when I was being beaten up. These were my best friends. And they would say to me, oh, I'm so sorry you're going to hell. And they really meant that, because that's what they were taught down at St. Mary's parochial school. And of course, as you know, coming from more conservative Protestant background, all Catholics are going to hell too. And so the way the vision of Vatican II, that these are separated brethren, and they weren't denying that there was some brokenness. It's not cheap, you know, kind of romantic ecumenism. It faces seriously, there are divisions, but they are brothers, they are sisters in Christ. So how can we create bring the church back into unity? And it's there in the documents, and a wonderful humility, I think, out of the Catholic Church, saying there are things we've lost that our Protestant separated brethren can restore to the church.
I was thinking that you were talking in your church when you took over that more evangelical congregation, bringing the liturgy that if you look at Martin Luther in the best sense, it was the opposite. He had the liturgy, yeah. but he was bringing back the evangelical perspective right. of the time period.
That's right. And of course, Lutherans were called evangelische. I mean, that was, they weren't called Lutherans. It was the evangelische church, the evangelical church, the gospel. And yeah.
So there you are. You're still a pastor, though, and you're becoming convicted.
That's right. And however, I was also getting along in my age. And actually, when I started that final little venture in Anglicanism, this part of this realignment, we started a new church. Interestingly enough, again, Prevenient Grace. We took over a closed Catholic church. So and it was a beautiful, it was a post-Vatican II sanctuary, but it was a beautiful one. And all the sacraments were in the stained glass all around. The Stations of the Cross were in the window. And that's where it became our home, this sort of refugee community from Christ Church Hamilton. It was called Christ Redeemer Anglican Church. But I had told them, and I had told my bishop at the time, that I'm not sure I talked so much about my ambivalence. I did feel the Holy Spirit wanted me to do this work, but it was just to get this church started. And then I was going to retire. And that's when Anglicanorum Cedibus came out. And so the last little piece of this was I called the community together while I was pastor of Christ the Redeemer Anglican Church to meet at 8 o'clock on Sunday morning to explore this document, because it was a letter to Anglicans. So right. We were Anglicans. Yep. So I want to listen to this letter from Pope Benedict to Anglicans. And we had a group that got together for 20 Saturdays over the course of a year. And Tom Howard was essentially the teacher. I mean, he helped us read the documents and interpret it. We read his book on being a Catholic, which is, I think, one of the finest books of speaking, particularly to evangelicals, about what Catholicism is. Yeah. And then at the end of that, I threw a fleece out, because my retirement was coming up. And I said, if 12 of you would join me, once I retire, I will start an ordinariate parish, if I can find 12 people. Well, I had 9 people sign up. And then over time, a 10th person signed up. And then quite literally on December 31st, I was having lunch with a friend of mine. I shared this whole vision. We'd been out of touch with each other. And he was so enamored with the vision. He said, well, the next day he had gone home, talked to his wife. He sent me an email. You now have number 11 and 12. And that was January 1st, 2012. That was the day the American Ordinariate was started. Well, and on January 2nd, I found out that Jeffrey Steenson, this old friend, former Episcopal bishop, comrade in battle, had become the ordinary of the ordinariate. And at that point, I knew God say, now, all the not yet, not yet, not yet, now. And so I gathered that group of 12 people, and we began the process of being catechized. Tom Howard was, again, our catechist. And we prepared ourselves to be received into the Catholic Church. I had a number of obligations of marriages I'd committed myself to do. So with Monsignor Steenson's permission, I delayed my entrance to the church till I finished all my sacerdotal duties as an Anglican priest. And on August the 15th, 2012, I was appropriately the feast of Our Lady's Assumption. I was received and confirmed into the Catholic Church. Meanwhile, I was waiting for my to see if I, and I became a priest. This was the hardest thing. You know, I told you I was a priest, called to the priesthood as a little boy, but I had to lay that down to become a Catholic, and there was no guarantee I would
Because that really is keeping the two issues separate.
Yeah, yeah.
Become Catholic,
that's right,
and vocation are
but
separate issues.
At this point, I was committed to being a Catholic, and whether or not I became a priest in it. But it was hard.
Right.
And of course, I
Well, to a certain extent, it was a bit fortunate for you because you were near retirement.
That's right. I wasn't losing a job. I mean, in a certain sense, and the one great benefit of the Episcopal Church is the church pension fund. It's the oldest and most established pension fund in the history of the human race. So finances were not an issue. I had a kind of, again, God's grace and providence of allowing me freedom to do this. But I then was in the process of waiting. And of course, I think as you probably know, there was a rather significant process of putting a dossier together, psychological tests, formation, theological formation, all kinds of things that were part of this process. And all my papers going off to Rome. And as I said, I was dealing now with the largest, oldest and largest bureaucracy in the world. And who knows, you don't find out. They don't keep sending you emails. Your papers are here or there. You just, and we were waiting. And
sometimes you wonder if it's like the end of Indiana Jones, that first movie where they take the Ark of the Covenant and put it in this huge warehouse that goes as big as the eye can see. That's I wonder if that's where my application ended up.
Well, that's the thing. I had no idea. Interesting enough, matter of fact, it was when I first met you at that conference in Houston, where Monsignor Lopes, who was the liaison, he was one of the speakers of that. He's the liaison with the Ordinariate from the Congregation of Doctrine of the Faith, which is the part of the Curia where all this stuff goes and all the approval comes. I bumped into him at that conference, and Monsignor Steenson introduced me, and he immediately recognized my name, because it's an odd name, and he said, "Oh, we just approved you for ordination." But there was only one detail missing, the Pope's signature, because only the Pope can dispense a priest from the vow of celibacy. Well, next week, Pope Benedict resigned. So the adventure continued. But as it turned out, and actually I feel quite, again, thankful to the Lord for this, it turns out I actually was Pope Benedict's last signature as a rescript for as permission to be. Cardinal O'Malley ordained me a priest on a year ago. April of 20th of 2013, and we, our little congregation of folk who had grown to that point to about 25 people was formed. We took the name St. Gregory the Great, which seemed an appropriate name for a ordinary parish, Gregory being the Pope who sent the missionaries to convert the Angles and to help unify the Celtic Christians that were already there back into union with Rome. So that seemed...
Are you at that little Catholic church that you... Were you able to keep that facility? Were you?
We didn't. No. That was my old. That was my, Christ Redeemer continues. Okay, take that whole. I took just a small part of that congregation and a few more when they found out I was doing this. Right. I had to be very, and I think appropriately, very careful. I was not trying to. I just kind of said what I felt God was calling me to, and anyone who wanted to join me could.
Yeah.
Some people were quite shocked, and there was a fair amount of hostility here and there.
You know, when I was down at that Houston thing and I spoke, one of the parts that I emphasized to the gathered men who were all the original candidates for the Ordinariate is I talked about that parable of our Lord in Luke 14, where he talks about when you're invited to a wedding feast, you don't take the front row seat. You take the back row.
Right.
And I've often thought that that's something especially not just for former clergy coming into church need to understand, but all of us in our journey is that, you know, we rise to a level and then we come in and think, well, I'm coming in at this. It's really a growth in humility.
It is.
In the step into the church.
And I remember actually someone who came before me into the Catholic Church, I know you've published his biography. He was a Pentecostal minister named Assemblies of God, Ernie Freeman, his name. He said, we really need a spirit of humility for us and not have any sort of messianic complex that God has sent us to save the Catholic Church. Right. And there are a lot of challenges of the Catholic Church, as you well know, and a lot of need. I mean, I do believe that this, whatever... I mean, I rejoice in being a Catholic and all that that has given me. But I also believe there is something that we bring, and Benedict said that. He said, come and bring your gifts to enrich, it's not just to preserve it for your sake, but to enrich the Catholic Church. And I do think that Protestant clergy, particularly those who come from an evangelical and charismatic background, I think it's no accident God's calling us into the church to bring some of the gifts we have.
And at the same time you come into the church, so does Pope Francis.
Yeah.
I mean, how has Pope Francis also been a model?
Well, as we're taping this, I was just a few weeks in Rome, our ordinariate, it was a clergy pilgrimage. We had about 100 of us, which was probably a new experience for Pope Francis. He was blessing clergy, his priests, their priests' wives, and their priests' children. But we had about 100 of us there, and had a brief audience. It was more a photo op, but well, you know, it's an exciting time to be a Catholic, and it's also a more favorable time to be a Catholic, given some of the dark days we've been through in terms of the public press, the bad press we've had for the last decade. So it's exciting to see people being positive about Catholicism. Right. That's good. And of course, we will see, I mean, a friendly, positive personality is one thing. We will see what creative. I mean, I was struck just yesterday watching this tape of he made that he sent to a group of Pentecostal pastors. I mean, that was, again, coming out of a kind of charismatic background, knowing a lot about Pentecost, even though I was an Anglican, knew a lot about Pentecost. Because Pentecostalism is, in many ways, where the action is in the Protestant world.
A lot of growth there. I mean, really, in that world.
That's right.
It's almost like you were talking about the liturgy. So we have the ritual part, and then the evangelical. You know, the conversion of the heart. We need both. And Pope Francis is there reminding those are both absolutely true. But don't forget the poor.
Yeah.
Don't forget
that
all this is about living Christ in the world. And how can we reach out to those that are lost or abandoned or don't know our Lord? I mean, that's what he's reminding. He's not abandoning the other two.
No.
He's saying this is what it's all about.
Right,
it's living it out. We have an email, Father. Gloria from Texas writes, what is the typical process like for an Anglican who wants to become part of the ordinariate? I have some friends who might be interested but don't know much about the specifics of how to join.
Well, there is a website, you know, if you just Google Anglican Ordinariate, or it's the real name is the Personal Ordinariate of the Chair of St. Peter, and we can begin that process. I mean, it depends what's going on, whether it's individuals who want to join the ordinariate, or congregations of people, or an Anglican or Episcopal priest who wants to explore becoming a priest. But it's a wonderful journey, so please come. I mean, I do believe this is a moment of a God moment in the history of the church, and that this is something profound in the reunification of Western Christianity. I really do believe that.
If I could ask about 2 minutes to go, where was Our Lady in all this?
Well, I mean, since becoming a Catholic, it's been interesting now being a Catholic on the inside, even though in many ways I was a Catholic on the outside. Right. And what are the things I've most learned? Certainly, I remember saying this to a woman, Episcopal priest friend of mine, and she was kind of appalled by it. I said, you know, I have found a mother. And she said, I don't need a mother. But there's been the whole motherly, maternal, of all the things that Mary represents at so many levels, both in herself and in the icon of the church, and the maternal feminine, which is, you know, they're looking for it in the Protestant world by trying, especially in the Episcopal Church, by ordaining women and all that stuff. But they don't, you know, this is actually more truer to the feminine and the devotion to her. The second thing is the communion of saints. I've always believed in the communion of saints, and I would do teachings on it, but I actually have a sense of the experience of the communion of saints. I mean, I have it, particularly my parish at St. Gregory, I have sort of like this relationship with St. Gregory, you know, not just a historical interest in who he was, but a sense that he's praying for me, he's cheering us on. And that something of the charism, as I read his life, something of the charism of his extraordinary papacy is being given to our little community of 25 former Anglicans who are now Catholics.
So. And the discovery and the appreciation that he's always been guiding
them. So
they've always
been some of the rich things.
Standing beside them.
From the beginning, and maybe this is a good way to end, God, the day I made the decision back there in January of 2012 I have felt such a deep supernatural joy that's come on me. I mean, and it continues. It's not a romanticism about the Catholic Church. There's a lot of, we know, challenges, but it's just something about the joy of being in the truth, in the place, in home, as your show affirms.
Father Jurgan, thank you
very
much.
My privilege, Marcus.
Thank you very much
for having me.
And for you and your family, our prayers are there always, and ask for God's mercy and continued blessings. Thank you very much for joining us. And thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. It's my prayer that Father Jurgan's journey is an encouragement to you to follow our Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you. See you next week.